Hi, my name is Colin Hudzik. I'm a senior and I'm studying biology. And my presentation is MSL9 involved in perceiving cell wall damage? I work with a specific nematode known as a root-knot-nematode. They're microscopic roundworms which infect all types of plants, including our cash crops of corn, wheat, and soy. And every year they cause billions of dollars of damage. What they do is they infect the roots of the plant. So if you look here, this is an infected compared to a healthy root system. And there are tons of swollen tips and there are knots all over it. That's where they get their name, they create a knot. And this is just a better picture of what they look like in the wild. You can see there's big knots. And they travel up the vascular tissue until they find where they want to create their feeding site. And they divert water and nutrients away from the plant. And they slowly start to cause a lot of biotic stress. This is just another picture of what happens. Right here is called the apical meristem of the plant. And what happens is they are able to access the apical meristem easier, and they travel up through the vascular tissue right here, and they slowly travel up and create their sites. I work on a plant known as Arabidopsis thaliana. It's almost like a cousin to the mustard plant. And a lot of people probably wonder why I work on Arabidopsis. We have a Columbia wild type, which has its entire genome sequenced. So we're able to be able to look at it and find the genes that we want to see. And it's also extremely easy to grow in a lab. So I grow all of my plants on a little petri dish. If you can look, you can see that we did infect these with the nematodes and there are little knots on them. I work on three types of the Arabidopsis, a Columbia wild type, a plant that has an MSL9 mutant, which means it has no MSL9 in it, and then also another plant that has an overexpression of MSL9. It's been shown that when the Arabidopsis is missing 5 mechanosensitive channels, that the infection rate is extremely low for nematodes. So a mechanosensitive channel is a type of ion channel that allows certain ions to pass through when given certain mechanical stimuli, such as gravity, water, wind, and any type of pressure that would allow the cell to move. I work on a specific mechanosensitive channel known as MSL9. MSL9 stands for mechanosensitive channel of small conductance like 9. So if you look here, you can see that this is the channel right here, and around it is the plasma membrane. Ions are unable to travel through the plasma membrane, so they need channels to be able to do so. If you look here, this is what happens when there is no stimulus on the actual channel, so it's closed and it's hard for the pores to travel, the ions to travel through the pores. And here's when it's given a little bit of any type of mechanical stimuli, it's open and they're able to travel through. So back to my question, is MSL9 involved in perceiving cell wall damage? What happens is when the nematode does go through the plant, it goes in between cells and causes a lot of damage. And we're thinking that somehow MSL9, as well as MSL10, a sister gene, is somehow perceiving the cell wall damage, opening up its channel, allowing a flux of ions to pass through, which ends up cascading for a lot of signaling pathways, including the signaling pathway for jasmonic acid. Jasmonic acid is a naturally produced plant hormone which fights off infections of certain pathogens like the root-knot nematode. But studies have shown that the root-knot nematode has adapted to where it can actually use this jasmonic acid to help infect the plant, which is a little ironic since the plant produces it to fight off the infection. So I'm taking parts of the group of my plants and infecting them with nematodes, and I'm also taking another group in treating them with a chemical known as isoxaben. Isoxaben is known to disrupt cell walls, which is almost mimicking how the nematode would infect the plant. And what happens is the chemical starts to disrupt the cell wall and degrade it. So for those who aren't very familiar with a plant cell, this is just a typical plant cell. In blue around is the plasma membrane, and around the plasma membrane is the cell wall, which is composed of a lot of cellulose and other types of proteins. And the isoxaben starts to degrade it. I took pictures of 3 of the plants with a control that had nothing infected or treated, one with the nematodes and then one with the isoxaben. So if we look here, we can see that these are all the roots. If you look, the roots are very narrow and they look really healthy and the plant is surviving well. If you look, the length of the roots is very long. This is what happens when you infect them with the nematodes. If you look right here, you can see that there's a swollen root tip here and all around. That just lets us know that the plant is being infected by the nematodes and that more infection will increase. And then this is what happens when you treat it with isoxaben. So if you look, the root growth is extremely inhibited, as well as the swollen root tips, which are almost identical to how the nematode picture looked like. So I let these plants grow for a week in the treated and infected media, and I perform an RNA extraction. For those who don't know what RNA is, it's a nucleic acid that's generally single-stranded, and it is kind of the in-between from going from DNA to protein synthesis, so it's like a messenger. The amount of RNA that I do extract from the plants lets me know how much protein will have been produced by the plant, and I can see the amount of gene expression that's going on. After I begin to do the RNA extraction, I lyse the cells and break them down, and I go through a series of washes and columns and buffers, and I make sure there's no DNA in the actual solution, and then I take and extract the pure RNA. From there, I can create a complementary strand of DNA known as cDNA. The reason why we don't use cDNA, the reason why we don't use RNA is because it's a really unstable molecule. So we take the RNA as a template and use an enzyme known as reverse transcriptase, and we create a complementary strand of DNA from that so that I'm able to do PCR. PCR is polymerase chain reaction. To get from RNA to cDNA, I use a technique called reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction. But once my cDNA was created, I was able to just do standard PCR. When you're doing PCR, you need to use a forward primer, a reverse primer, and then DNA, as well as a supermix, which has nucleotides in it and enzyme for amplifying the amount of DNA. A primer is a short fragment of DNA that will attach itself to the gene so that when the DNA polymerase is added, it's able to amplify just the gene that I'm looking for. And just a little perspective of how much DNA I can amplify. A PCR reaction takes about 3 hours, and I'm able to amplify about a billion copies of my DNA. And cancer cells are known to also divide and produce a lot of DNA rapidly, but in the amount that I can produce in 3 hours, it would take a cancer cell about a month. After I've created my DNA, I'm able to run it through a gel electrophoresis. Electrophoresis means to travel through a current in a water-based environment. So I add a gel into a buffer solution, and in every well I add my samples of DNA. And on the top, I attach a negatively charged cathode. And to the bottom, I put a positively charged anode. And what happens is, since DNA is negatively charged, it moves from the cathode towards the anode. And then after electrophoresis is done, I'm able to observe it under a UV light. And smaller fragments will be able to travel further down. Since the gel has pores in it, the smaller DNA can travel faster than the larger DNA. And I'm able to see the amount of gene expression. When I'm looking at gene expression, I'm mainly looking for what is going on. Are the bands that I'm looking at lighter? Are they brighter? Or are they possibly just missing? So I tested four different kinds of genes. I'm looking at the jasmonic acid signaling pathways, as well as the jasmonic acid biosynthesis. And I'm also just checking to see how cell wall production is going on. And I'm also testing four controls. The first picture I'm going to show you is an MSL9 gene. It's an internal control. So if we look here, we can see that there are two bands missing, but they were from my MSL9 mutant line. So technically, there should have been no bands because there's no MSL9 in the plant. So it's kind of like me getting recognition that my experiment was correct. And if we look here, the 35S stands for an overexpression line. So if you look, it's a lot brighter than the wild type line, which also lets me confirm again that there is more MSL9 in my 35S than in the wild type. Back to my question, is MSL9 involved in perceiving cell wall damage? I was able to confirm this by looking at a specific gene known as PME3, which codes for pectin methyl esterase. So if you look at the MSL9 isoxaben line compared to the MSL9 J2, which is a stage of the root-knot nematodes, you can see that they're a lot lighter than all of the other bands. It looks better in the actual picture, but what I'm able to see is that the Isoxaben and the root-knot-nematodes are somehow shutting off this gene and that the expression is going down. So that's something we really like to look further into. JAS3 is a gene that codes for the jasmonic acid signaling pathways. So if you look, these genes for the nematodes were a lot brighter than when they were for the isoxaben, so that's another interesting thing that we'd like to look further into. The reason why I'm having missing bands is because for some reason my cDNA that I created wasn't working properly, but that's a part of science, is some failure. AOS is a gene that is for jasmonic acid biosynthesis. So if you look straight across the board, you can see that all of the bands look almost identical, which lets me know that when I'm infecting my plants with the root-knot nematodes and treating it with the isoxaben, that there's no difference in the biosynthesis of the gene, of the jasmonic acid. So it lets me know that when they're being infected and treated, that the jasmonic acid signaling pathway is being messed up, not just the production of the jasmonic acid. JAS2 is another jasmonic acid signaling pathway gene. If you look, you can see that when they're not infected with the nematodes, that for some reason they seem to be a lot brighter, so we're thinking that somehow the nematodes are shutting off this signaling pathway gene, and that's also something we're really interested in looking further into. My conclusions is that nematode infection impacts the expression of the jasmonic acid signaling pathways, but in different ways for different genes, and that pectin methylesterase expression is lower in the MSL9 mutants than compared to the wild types during cell wall condition of damage. So I'm going to be using qPCR next semester, which is quantitative PCR, which gives me, instead of just more of a visual expression, a mathematical expression, which just gives me more data to be able to prove that there's something going on in between the genes. I'd like to thank the ATP Summer Grant for funding my research, and I'd also like to thank the Office of Undergraduate Research for ordering my supplies, and I'd like to thank Dr. Heather Morella for teaching me my lab skills this summer.